Maybe I'll say the long punto, which I can emphasize. But before that, I have to refer to the fact that the Secretary General himself went to Manila last December in connection with what has been done thus far by the UN and the international community for the in connection with the destructions in the in Leyte in and he invited the secretary the president himself. He himself invited the president to attend this climate summit. So, as you know, alam natin lahat, napakalaking bagay ang naitulong ng United Nations as well as the international community. So, isang napakalagang bagay na magawa, masabi, ay mapaabot naman sa world leaders meeting in this climate summit. The gratitude of the Filipino people and the government for all the assistance that was extended to us. And by the way, this assistance is still going on. The program that the UN has put in place for the recovery, of course, in coordination with our RAE program, is quite meaningful, and we need it very much. So that's one, and the other one, of course, is it is very important to convey to the world leaders and to everybody else, because it's not known by many how we really are doing things there, because we have through the years developed not only the internal, or I would say the resilience of our people, but the specific things that we are doing in order to mitigate or have shall we say minimize the impact of destructions, these calamities. So there are specific things that our president can convey to the leaders on what must really be done to contribute to the body of knowledge in the international community. Of course, this is also an occasion, opportunity by the president, not just on a multilateral basis, to tell them of what he would like to convey, but also on the bilateral leader-to-leader discussions. It would be very enhancing for our overall international representation and to the representation of these countries. There are a quite of things that not just the mission, but actually, because you do not act, I would say, unilaterally, but it's always in tandem with Manila, with the appropriate authorities, on what could be or would be the initiatives of the Philippines in this connection. On the question of climate change, we have been very active, of course, in the whole range of negotiations. One, in the overall context that envelope this specific initiative, in the for instance, in the Rio Plus 20 meeting in Rio de Janeiro, setting forth the general direction by which all other measures might have to be pursued. We have been intimately engaged in those negotiations. On the areas relating to, for instance, on the climate fund, we have been engaged in those discussions. And as we prepare for Lima and then later on in Paris, which will be the culmination of all these events, we have been contributing our share in terms of bringing into forth specific issues that must be discussed and a specific matter that must be pursued. That's why here in the climate summit now, for instance, it will not be some kind of a usual business as usual, but countries or heads of states are expected to make pronouncements in terms of contribution, what they are going to do specifically in connection with climate change. And that is the special import for the summit meeting. And we serve as the vehicle for identifying and clarifying these issues. If we are speaking of relation or status of relation between the Philippines and the United Nations, I would say that it has been, I would say, a mutually beneficial relations. We, as a responsible member of the international community, have contributed quite immensely to not just the discourse, not just the negotiation, but actually even the, shall we say, manpower to the international community, to the UN, to advance objectives like global development, international peace and security. We have a sizable number of Filipino soldiers and police in various engagements in various countries where the UN are there to secure peace and security or contribute to the stabilization of certain areas. Like, well, we have just concluded the one in East Timor. We have still an ongoing in Haiti, and we have still policemen there. And we have still in other areas, of course, in UNDOF, in the separation line between Israel and the Golan Heights and Syria. As of the moment, since we have announced already our disengagement, or I would say winding up our engagement in this operations, there are only about, I think, 11 Filipino soldiers left, and they are left behind because they are taking care of the logistics, the weapons or armaments that have to be shipped back to the Philippines. So, insofar as our contribution to the UN, to the efforts of the international community, I would say that we have done our very best, our part. And if we look at it also on the, what the UN has done for us, which is a very important dimension to really examine, the classic, shall we say, example in terms of operational activities, responses to calamities, is really the Haiyan or the Yolanda case, you know. And there were other occasions in Iraq, calamities when they are all ready to help. But I think it is important that also to make it clear that we can handle it ourselves. And in fact, it is very important that what is being done by the international community and even the UN for that matter, the local authorities, our clusters, our cabinet ministers that handle that, should have the primus position in taking the lead. And in fact, they have to follow the lead of our government, of our people, in doing the job of for recovery, relief, recovery, and development. So throughout the years, I would say that we have a very beneficial and cooperation and engagement with the United Nations. You see, the Philippines has been doing its fair share, in fact, in the efforts of the international community, the UN, relating to international peace and security. And we have been engaged for some time. Yes, since 1958, and maybe one, it is high time to let others take the share. So we have made an announcement that we will be winding out in accordance with the usual rotation of troops replacement. But the repatriation of our soldiers have been somehow advanced because of the situations in the ground. You see, it has to be understood quite properly that in the separation line between Israel and Syria, in the Israeli side, that is the Alpha or the A line, and in the Syrian side is the Bravo or the P line. The activities of the rebels groups have been intensifying in the last few days, weeks, if not days. And so practically the position of the UN forces in the Bravo line were all moved to the Alpha line. It's just an observer in Mount Hermon and in position 80, which is near the, in the south, near the Israeli side that's left. But practically all are already in the Israeli side. And that's why it becomes problematic also that in terms of logistics, the accommodations, because they were all moved. And so it is not, in fact, only the Filipinos that will be going home, but also they are tremendously cutting on number of soldiers there, the UN soldiers, because according to the UN, they could not foresee in the short term and even in the medium term that they will be able to return to the Bravo side, you know, on this manning or that. And so the repatriation came about and only 11 were left behind. But you see, we have clarified it to everybody, to the troop contributing countries, to the UN, to the Security Council, that our disengagement should be in accordance with the rotation period or schedule, because we do not want to disrupt the engagement of the international community on these matters to promote peace and security or contribute in that region. But events on the ground have precipitated or has advanced our movement. So that's what happened in the Golan Heights or Undob soldier. Oh, there are quite a number of issues that the Philippines has been engaged with the United Nations. I can name, for instance, the issue relating to disabilities. You see, what happened there is when the CRPD, this is the Convention of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, was adopted. This was in 2006. But the medium MDGs were adopted in 2000. And so it has been claimed that attention towards persons with disabilities have not been in the radar screen of MDGs. So the Philippines took it an important initiative to see to it that a focus of discussion will also be raised relating to a person with disabilities, attention for what they can do for development, attention for them being involved in decision making, attention for what they must be getting in terms of assistance. And so the Philippines initiated a linkage of this discussion. We pursued several resolutions, and in fact this culminated last year in the high-level meeting on the way forward, that was the theme, towards an all-inclusive disability development agenda towards 2015 and beyond. This was the high-level meeting last year, just like that we are having now, the high-level meeting on climate change. That was a Philippine initiative last year. And we are continually engaged in this because it is a very important dimension. They are not only as an object of assistance or an object of help, or but they have a role to play for development and decision making. And of course, very important is to push forward their rights as persons. The other element that the other issue that we are intimately engaged is the question of women, the question of women empowerment, women equality, gender equality, and opportunity for income, power, and all that. And we have been very strong on these issues. Related to this, of course, is the violence against women, you know. And all our engagement there, as we are a member of the Commission on the Status of Women, and we are a member of the, and we have a representation in SIDAO. This year, in fact, the Commission on the Status of Women 58 session, the Philippines under, yours truly was the president of this Commission on the Status of Women this year session. So this is a continuing engagement that it is high in our work, because this is forming part of the whole, the third pillar of one of the pillars of our foreign policy, and that is really to protect our nationals. Because issues would come in which are very important relating to this, and for instance, the issue of migrant workers, the issue relating to human trafficking. And in fact, I can also mention in this regard that about 3 years ago, the discussions are still continuing and pushing, is the adoption of a UN resolution. It was co-sponsored by the Philippines and Belarus. This is in human trafficking. And while we were pushing for the traditional areas of concern, like treating the victims as victims rather than criminals, and also focusing on those doing shenanigan, or shall we say, that facilitate this illegal or exploitation, is also having for the first time an inclusion of attention towards the supply side, I mean the demand side. It has always been the focus about the supply, and it is very important that we have to look at it in totality. Although it's still a weak provision in this resolution, we need to develop further, but and it is left to member states to do something to embellish the provision, but it now make reference to what must be done on the demand side. And therefore, this brings into fore the fourth P that we would like to push. Because if I will have to dwell on this a little bit, for instance, in relating to TIP, we are always talking about the three P's. This is protection, promotion, and prosecution. They say that we are okay on promotion and protection, but maybe we are low on prosecution. Well, we are not putting any excuses. We are doing very well now. I mean, we are moving. But we are not an adversarial society or system like here. You slip in the, shall we say, in the sidewalk, you will be sued or whatever. It's always suing all the time. But the other P that we will emphasize really is partnership. Because this is not a concern of just the sending or the supply receiving or the supply and demand. It's a concern of all. And that's why it is very important to really appreciate the partnership, the mutuality of interest in trying to solve problems of this kind. Well, I think we should all be proud, Filipinos, the nation, our country, that our president is here in a meeting which is attended by heads of state and governments. It is a singular opportunity to project himself as a president, us as a country, a people, and our country, our ability to actually survive on all these adversities, and at the same time survive and thrive, and at the same time also contribute to a body of knowledge, a body of elements that can form towards what can be developed as the response of the global community towards this problem of climate change. You know, it has been said that if we are not going to do really something very urgent and very dramatic in its dimension relating to the environment, very soon maybe humanity will be, or Earth might be facing very soon a heap of garbage, and we will all be gone by then because of tremendous changes in the environment. Now, it is also very important for us to not just dramatize, but to really drive home the point what are needed in our country. Because the Philippines, well, actually in Asia, Southeast Asia, in Asia, there are 7 countries out of the 10 most vulnerable countries in the world in the environment. 7 are in Asia. And the Philippines is the 3rd most vulnerable country. And that's why it's very important that this is appreciated. And the becoming our president here is really bring this to a greater height and importance. And also, of course, to hone in to what we would like to happen. And this is really to focus on what must be done in terms of climate adaptation. Of course, climate mitigation is very important, and that we have to contribute, but it is far more, I would say, an immediate that support, help, and the mobilization of either financial or otherwise should take this into consideration, because vulnerable countries, first and foremost, that they really would need would be matters relating to adaptation.